one half of the impetus behind the Maccabees project, the other half is homesick. Yonder Gillham from Boston College, as some of you know. Here's how the Maccabees project began. I've been co-directing an excavation in northern Israel for, from 1997 through 2011. And unexpectedly discovered a building, a monumental administrative complex, that is implicated in an episode that's recounted in First Maccabees. And for about a decade, I interpreted my discoveries completely, 100%, uninflectedly, in line with what it said in First Maccabees. First Maccabees said that there had been an event there, that the Maccabean brother Jonathan had been involved in battle there, and that the site had been taken in battle. And a few years ago, when I began to really seriously think about the historical implications of this, I began to realize that it simply couldn't be true. And yet, something had actually happened at the site at the time that it said in First Maccabees. So I was confronted with this complete conundrum that something happened in the way that it said in this text that I had read as truth, but it couldn't have happened in the way that the text said. And I realized that in order to make sense of this, I needed help, because I'm an archaeologist. I'm not a scholar of these ancient texts. And I began reading, among other articles that I read, were some by Katell, who is our guest here today, this weekend, and decided that just simply reading on my own wasn't going to be enough, because the complexity of the historiography and the historical writing of this period and the complexity of the scholarship was more than I could simply take in on my own. I needed people to be talking about it in front of me so that I could actually understand. And I also wanted the archaeological evidence that I thought was pertinent to be part of the story. And I didn't really know a way to make that happen simply by writing articles, because I don't know about all of you, but I don't think I sure don't read everything. And I'm not sure that everybody does. So I just didn't think that the solution would be that I would write an article saying what I thought, and then, oh, presto, everything would be solved. So I conceived of this interdisciplinary research collaborative. And this semester is its launch, as it were. And this particular couple of days is our first efforts to bring both scholars into dialogue with each other, and also with lots of other people that might have interests in these topics, and hence the Maccabees project. So yesterday we had two events. We had a lunch at Pillow House and for undergraduates, and we had a public dialogue last night at Kehilat Israel, which is a synagogue in Brookline. And today we are honored to have a scholarly colloquium with half of our scholarly duo present, and that is Katell Berthelot, who comes to us from the University of Aix-en-Provence in France. Katell is an historian of Jews and Judaism in the Hellenistic and Roman periods, and her scholarship is extraordinarily wide-ranging. It's actually amazing. So all by herself, she can represent all the points of view that we need right now, and it will be fine. So she has written on a huge array of topics, including, just to hit the book-related highlights and not coming in all of the articles, accusations of misanthropy against the Jews in the Greco-Roman world and the Jewish responses to those charges, comparisons between Jewish ethical teachings and Greco-Roman philosophy, the history of Jewish interpretations of biblical texts, especially to those pertaining to the conquest of the Promised Land and the fate of the Canaanites, which was a subject that she held forth in my archaeology of the Holy Land class this morning to a barrage, a non-stop barrage of questions from students. And And finally, the impact of empires on the formation of ancient Judaism. She has just finished a book on the Hasmonean Wars of Conquest, and it are insights from that particular research, primarily, that she will be helping us work through with her today in this colloquium on the theme of the Maccabean conquests and the idea of the actual concept of the Promised Land. So, Katell, thank you for being here and for enduring endless hours of talk and questioning and being open to two more. Here we go.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me and for giving me the possibility to present my ideas in this forum and in this wonderful building, amazing place. So I'm very glad to be here with you today. And as Andrea just said, so I finished a book on the Hasmonean Wars, especially the Wars of Conquest. And in that book, the main thing that I attempted to do was to challenge current historiographical paradigm, according to which the Maccabees or the Hasmoneans or the Hasmonean dynasty tried to reconquer the Promised Land, tried to reconquer the land given by God to Israel. With one strong implication, which is not systematically put forward in all the scholarly works that can be read on the topic, but it is relatively present. Which is, if they saw themselves as being bound to this mission of reconquering the land, they were also looking at the populations around as being Canaanites, and you know, applied the law of the Cherem found in the Book of Deuteronomy in the Bible, or try to expel them if we follow the scenario found in the Book of Exodus, because you know they saw these people as descendants of the Canaanites who had to be expelled or destroyed according to the biblical commandments. So I am challenging this view. I'm arguing that the model of Joshua is barely mentioned at all in 1 Maccabees, and barely present at all in the second book of Maccabees, that Josephus, who is rewriting in a personal and creative way the evidence from 1 Maccabees and from other sources that he had, does not present the Hasmoneans as trying to imitate Joshua or to reconquer the biblical land. And I'm trying to look at all the evidence that scholars have put forward as arguments to sustain their thesis and to deconstruct every piece of evidence and to show that there is a different reading that is possible, a different interpretation. And that's the first stage of my work. And the second stage is to look at the evidence and try to make sense of it in a different way, taking all the evidence together. Also the archaeological evidence, and also the faint echoes of the Maccabean Wars that we find in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and later on in Rabbinic literature. And just, this is not something we're going to talk about today, but just to let you know, in Rabbinic literature, we have nearly nothing about the territorial expansion of the Hasmonean state. Nearly nothing, like if it had never happened. There is nearly no memory of the political military achievements of the Hasmonean dynasty. The only thing that is remembered is the liberation story which the rabbis reformulated as the Chanukah story. So this in itself is a very striking thing. Just as if, imagine, let's go down to science fiction. Imagine a huge disaster. The state of Israel is taken over, disappears, and Jews in 300 years would not remember the existence of the state of Israel for 80 years. Imagine, that's That's what is happening in our sources. Isn't it striking? So, but we will not reach the rabbinic literature today. We will stay within the first book of Maccabees, and we will first look at some of the scholarly works that have been written, in which you can find this paradigm of, you know, the reconquest of the land. Of course, I just have a few quotations, and fairly enough, you could say, oh, but these are very short quotations, and we don't have the bigger context of the work, so if you want, you're very welcome to go to the library and find these sources and read them by yourselves, and you can tell me if I misquoted them. I'm just giving a few examples. I shall put this. Give a few examples of the paradigm. And then we will look at a few texts in 1 Maccabees that have been used quite often to demonstrate the paradigm. And I've picked up 4 examples. They are all important. I'm not sure we'll be able to speak, to discuss all of them today, but we will see how far we get. So, one of the very first examples that I found in the history of research and in the historiography of the Hasmonean period that documents this view of the Hasmoneans as following the model of Joshua and so on is in an absolutely brilliant article by Hans. Johannan Levy, which he published in German in 1933. Levy was later to emigrate to Palestine, so he escaped the Holocaust, and he taught in Israel in the 50s. He taught history, Jewish history in Israel in the 50s. He was a genius. He was a true genius. And probably know his work on fire. And this article is a very important article, but still, in passing, he makes this remark. I'm going to read my English translation, not the original German, but you can read the German. Simon thus refers himself to the divine promise, which remained Ethiopian, to Moses and Joshua, according to which the land up to the Mediterranean Sea was promised to the Israelites. Now, what are we talking about? Who is this Simon? Simon is the brother of Judah Maccabee. And here he is referring to a passage that is the fourth passage in your handout. I'm not going to look at it in detail right now, but just to give you a clue. We are in the around the year 136-35 BCE. Judah and Jonathan are dead. Simon is now the Judean high priest. Judea has reached a kind of autonomy, but still the relationship with the Seleucids is very problematic. And suddenly, Antiochus VII, the Seleucid king, expresses some kind of hostile designs, sends an ambassador to Simon, and claims that the Judeans have taken lands that belong to him, to the king, and that they should give them back and pay tribute, etc. And Simon answers, and you will see the next later, the beginning of his answer is to say, we have not taken foreign lands, but we have retaken the inheritance of our fathers. In Greek, kleronomia ton paternitum.
This is on page 7.
Yeah.
Under D, the inheritance of our fathers.
Yeah. This is the very last text in the handout. If you look at verse 33, Simon spoke and answered to him, we have not taken land that is not ours, nor have we conquered anything that belongs to others. Rather, we have taken the inheritance of our fathers, which had been unjustly conquered by our enemies, using one opportunity or another, etc. So, this is what Levy is referring to in this article. And so he interprets Simon's answer and this expression, the inheritance of all fathers, as the divine promise to Moses and Joshua. So this implies that for Levi, Simon saw himself as, you know, bound to reconquering the land according to the promise of God to Abraham's descendants. And then Moses and Joshua. Okay. So that's one of the first occurrences of the paradigm in history. Then I jump, there are many that I could have mentioned, but I jump to William Davis' book, The Territorial Dimension of Judaism, an important book published in 1972. And here we read, the story of the conquest and occupation of the land under Joshua was vivid in the Maccabean mind, and it continues in the battle of the nationalists of the first century, and this is something we're not going to talk about today. So, the story of the conquest and occupation of the land under Joshua was vivid in the Maccabean mind.
That's a great phrase.
Hmm?
That's a great phrase.
That's a great phrase. Okay. Next example. Jonathan Goldstein. Goldstein. In his translation and commentary of 1 Maccabees, which was published in the Encore Bible series and therefore was very influential. Until now, this is the translation and the commentary that most people will intensely use. And there are many problems with this commentary. And for instance, Jonathan Goldstein writes on page 293, pious Jews kept separate from the Gentiles to avoid all contact with idolatry. Gentiles easily interpreted the Jews' self-separation as reflecting the Jews' hatred for the human race, what he has in mind is misanthropia, and reacted by hating the Jews in return. And he refers to attacks on diverse, which is actually a story of the siege of Jerusalem by Antiochus VII. In the time of John accounts. Anyway, this factor, however, is not sufficient to explain why the news of Judah's victory and restoration of the temple, here he is referring to 1 Maccabees 5, right? Another chapter in 1 Maccabees, in which we hear that the nations round about became hostile to the Jews that were living in their midst, and then Judah tries to rescue these Jews. So it's not sufficient to explain why the news of Judah's victory and restoration of the temple led the neighboring nations to try to exterminate the Jews. The decisive factor was surely the Jews' claims to possess the entire area by divine right, claims based upon the Torah and reinforced by prophecies. Judah's victories could only be taken as a sign that God's favor again rested upon the Jews. Now, the Jews expected, and the Gentiles feared, the fulfillment of the prophecies. Our author, still, that is, 1 Maccabees, still portrays Judah as a second Joshua. Judah's contemporaries, Jewish and Gentile, probably did so too. We can understand how Gentiles came to view Jews living in their territory as a fifth column, preparing the way for the new conquest of the Promised Land. Gentiles so minded would show no mercy to Jews. Now, this passage is so problematic, we could spend just 30 minutes deconstructing every sentence. Like, not just one thing. For instance, we have no evidence of any Greek, Roman, Egyptian author ever knowing, being aware of the book of Joshua or Joshua himself. The pagan authors, the Greco-Roman authors, knew nearly nothing about the Bible, and certainly not the story of the conquest and the prophecies. So this is pure speculation, total historical delirium. Imagining that the people in Transjordan or in Phoenicia were reading the Bible and saying, look, this is written in Isaiah and so of Jeremiah, they will come back and they will reconquer all land. This is total imagination, science fiction. Okay. Let's continue. A more recent example is Zev Safrai. So in an article in the collective volume, an article entitled The Gentile Cities of Judea Between the Hasmonean Occupation and the Roman Liberation. And he writes, the conquest or liberation of Judea is, as we know, a central explicit divine command obeyed by the Israelites ever since the days of Joshua. The Hasmoneans would undoubtedly regard themselves as bound to this mission, as is confirmed by some evidence, but this is beyond the scope of the present discussion. Okay. And a few lines afterwards, he invokes, I quote, the deep influence of the biblical concept of the conquest of the land on the literature of the Hasmonean period, which is a more general point. It's not only about the Hasmoneans themselves or about the Book of Maccabees. But here, you know, I draw your attention to the way it is formulated. The Hasmoneans would undoubtedly regard themselves as bound to this mission. And the more you go with the passing of time, it seems that the paradigm is so firmly rooted in scholarship that it's something that cannot even be discussed. It's just self-evident. And this is what I found fascinating, I mean, really in terms of methodology in general and the humanities in general, how people just repeat something endlessly without ever, you know, challenging or thinking twice about. I found this case very, very striking.
And you think it originated with Hans Sloan?
No, I don't think it was. In Hans Sloan's article, it's just a remark in passing. It's like, it is nearly, like, without even paying attention to what he's really saying that he writes that. His article is not focused on this issue. On the contrary, it's focused on the Hellenistic models that influence the Hasmoneans or some Judean writers in the second century BC. Yeah, I think it's very convincing. But, and you have hints of that in previous writers. Even in Gret's history of the Jewish people, it's not completely clear because it's not very explicit, but once he uses the term reconquer in the Hasmonean context. So he doesn't, nowhere does he say that the Hasmoneans plan to reconquer the land, etc., but just in one sentence, he uses the term reconquer. So it's tiny because of the history.
Do some of these other authors, Katell, cite him? Do some of these authors cite one another?
Mm-hmm. Yes, they do. Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. So I just want to comment a little bit on Zev Safrai's quotation. There is also a very big question raised by the first sentence. The conquest or liberation of Judea, you don't know why he says Judea. He says Judea because of the Hasmonean context, because in the time of the Hasmoneans, it's about Judea. But if he wanted his sentence to make sense, he should really have written the land of Israel, because the commandment given by God in the Torah is not about Judea, it's about the land of Israel. So anyway. But the conquest or liberation of Judea, land of Israel, let's say, is, as we know, a central and explicit divine command obeyed by the Israelites ever since the days of Joshua. This is a very problematic statement. because, and here, I rely on the work of the biblical scholar, the Israeli biblical scholar Moshe Weinfeld, who was a great specialist of the Book of Deuteronomy. Moshe Weinfeld said in his book on the promise of the land, which is really dedicated to this issue of the gifts of the land to Israel, etc. He refers to this issue of whether the command to conquer the land is an everlasting command or a one-time command, a command that is bound to a certain historical context. And he says that actually, in the history of Jewish exegesis, most commentators, especially medieval commentators, would not consider like the non-Jews living in the land as Canaanites that were to be expelled or eradicated. And the land was not necessarily to be reconquered by force. And he says, so Moshe Weinfeld says, that only Nachmanides was the exception to the rule. Nachmanides said that at any time, in any period, Israel is obliged to reconquer the land and to fight against the the non-Jewish populations in the land, no matter whether they are considered descendants of Canaanites or not. Just, it's an obligation, it's a permanent obligation for Israel to reconquer the land, to eradicate idolatry, and etc. But he says that this is a minority view. Nachmanides is not representative of the main Jewish tradition. And another example is the opinion of Rabbi Reines, who was one of the founders, the creators of the Mizrahi political party at the end of the 19th, beginning of the 20th century, the religious Zionist party. Rabbi Reines argued that the Jews had a command to settle in the land, to live in the land, but that the only way they could achieve this goal was by negotiation or buying lands. The military option was completely excluded. The land was not to be taken back by force, by war. And he was one of the founding fathers of the Zionist Religious Party. So it is very interesting to see that this question of whether the land has to be reconquered is debated in the history of Jewish thought. And so when Zev Sefai writes, it's, as we know, a central and explicit divine command obeyed by the Israel, he's just not aware that this is really totally problematic, that it's absolutely not self-evident. Not only is it false, but it shows a lack of consciousness of the problematic and complicated issues that lie behind this this topic. Anyway, so I just wanted to emphasize that. Now, to make you understand that really, we are reading things written by people who I think didn't really reflect about the topic enough. So, another last example, and then we'll show here a different voice, just to change, right? Change. So, last very, very recent example, Israel Schatzman, a great specialist of the Asmonean and Herodian armies, writes in his article on Jews and Gentiles from Judas, Maccabees to John Hyrcanus, according to contemporary Jewish sources, in 2007. The wars of Mattathias and Judas against the Gentiles were an opportune occasion to implement the Deuteronomic laws, and hence were modeled on the wars of Joshua against the Canaanite peoples. And later, John Hyrcanus sought to implement the aspiration that had emerged in the time of Judah to rule Eretz Israel. And there he quotes the very same passage that I mentioned previously in connection with Lev's article 1:15-33. Which is their passage that comes again, is quoted from. I'll find a different voice, which is that of Moshe Weinfeld in this book, The Promise of the Land, The Inheritance of the Land of Canaan by the Israelites. It's a chapter that was originally published in Hebrew in 1984. So precisely in connection with this problematic passage, when Maccabees 15:33-35, Simon's answer to Antiochus VII, Weinfeld writes, during the Asmonean period, it is not the conquest of land that is referred to, but rather holding on to inherited territory. And later, he writes, throughout all their conquest activities, The Hasmoneans never relied on the ancient laws of the Pentateuch concerning the dispossession of the Canaanites and the inheritance of the Promised Land. The old Genesis traditions were rewritten in the light of contemporary events, but as a matter of practice, the Hasmoneans neither mentioned nor implemented the ancient laws concerning the conquest of the land. Here you see a very, very different voice, very different opinion. But the Book of Beitfeld doesn't seem to be used much by people working on the Hasmonean period.
Why do you think it is?
Why didn't they?
Yeah, are there scholarly groups and lineages where people tend to quote and utilize one set of scholars but not another?
Because Beitfeld is a biblical scholar. A scholar of the Hebrew Bible, of Deuteronomy, and they don't think that even tackles the topic of the Hasmonean Wall in this book.
It's not a logical place to turn.
There's already so much on the Hasmoneans themselves that you have to read everything. It's already.
When you said the old Genesis traditions were rewritten, that the divine promises about the land, is that what that refers to?
I think he has the Book of Jubilees in there.
The Book of.
Oh, you mean he's not referring to Maccabees?
No, because Maccabees does not rewrite Genesis.
That's what I wondered, yeah.
Yeah. So I think he here is making a more general point. He's saying in that period, some Judean writers rewrote Genesis, but as a matter of practice, the Hasmoneans, within that context, they themselves neither mentioned nor implemented the ancient laws.
Can I ask another question? So then this may pertain to the question of the influence of wine development. This is an important list, and clearly there are an important set of names making these claims, but actually these aren't the top Israeli scholars dealing with the Second Temple period during the time when Weinfeld is writing, right? So Weinfeld's own historical colleagues at the university aren't included on this list.
Well, I could have added
that's what I'm asking, right?
Whose book was published in 87,
is
a professor at the Hebrew University. But I must say that I have on my side two other main fossils from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. Menachem Kister, from the Talmud department, in the book that, the book anymore with me. Anyway, the book that I have edited, a conference that I organized with Menachem Eshman from the Hebrew University, and this book Menachem Kister wrote a wonderful article in which he, again, it's not the main topic that he's addressing, but he doesn't believe also that there was a Hasmonean project of reconquering the land and things like that. And recently, Daniel Schwartz has had an interview with a French journal in which he says exactly what I'm trying to argue in my book.
Right, so
that's
good, that's really good. That's really good company to keep. Actually, what I'm asking though, and I just don't know, right, is what you mentioned Doral Mendels, but Gidali Alon, Shai Gaffney, any of the people who've written general surveys or particular Second Temple period, the detailed work on First and Second Maccabees, say from the 70s and 80s, those would be the contemporaries to Weinfeld, and I'm wondering whether they were making this claim or just perhaps unaware of it, because there are two ways, right? There's sort of two ways this can go, right? People could make the claim, or actually be so persuaded, like you, the claim is so outrageous that not even necessarily engage in it. So I don't know. I mean,
well, they were just busy with other issues, topics.
Yeah.
Like for instance, Ishaya Gaffney.
Well, that's a bad example. Though he wrote a whole book on land, I'm trying to think of. So he would have taught, Second Temple period classes back then, but.
You have Doron Mendels, you have Israel Schatzman. These are pretty, major senior scholars from Hebrew. You have Oyer Rappaport, the main specialist.
So he does it too. Okay.
Yeah, he's more subtle and more nuanced, but he still gets into it as well. Both in his commentary in Hebrew and in his recent book, in his recent book on the Hasmonean dynasty, the published in 2013 in Hebrew also. So.
Were you trying to figure out, Jonathan, if this was some kind of fringe?
Well, I am trying to figure out how pervasive, and I don't know. I mean, though honestly, it's funny to me. I mean, it seems so outrageous. I can't believe anyone ever said it. And I want you to keep going. I may get some more questions that I want to introduce those now. Not that what you're saying is outrageous. The view that you're coming also seems just outrageous. Or not fully thought out, precisely as you're saying. But precisely because of that, right? To the degree to which you're so persuasive that it's so outlandish, right? One wonders, you know, people who didn't explicitly counter it aren't necessarily endorsing it.
Oh no, of course, yeah. I wouldn't say it. Somebody who hasn't
engaged,
tackled the topic, has that it means that he agrees. Of course not. But you know, like for instance, Hanan Escher in a footnote in an article say exactly that. Always referring to 1 Maccabees 15, that's the main thing. So I think it became part of
right, but there are, my point is, and I'll stop. There are though pretty important names here who you haven't put on the list yet, and maybe that they're alone. Menachem Stern.
Yeah, Menachem Stern has a little passage in which he also goes in the direction of saying that the Hasmoneans tried to reconquer the land of Israel.
Absolutely.
In my introduction to my book, I have many, many more quotations. But I picked those up because they were focused on Joshua, and we will see more specifically the issue of Joshua and the Cherem in the text, in the passages from 1 Maccabees that I've chosen.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas there are some other ways of formulating the paradigm that we do not necessarily focus on Joshua explicitly.
Right.
So this is why I chose these passages and not.
So some of these other scholars may not have focused on Joshua either.
Yeah, some do say they wanted to reconquer the land of Israel, the land given by God to Israel, or there are different ways to formulate it, or to reconquer the Davidic kingdom, maybe. But in the end, it's always the same. It's like to reestablish the people of Israel on the land of Israel with full sovereignty and so on and so on. And what I'm challenging is that this was the aim of the wars. And this is what, you know, what got them started.
Mm-hmm.
Can I still ask you for clarification about the Weinfeld? When he starts to say it's not the conquest of the land that he is referred to, but rather holding onto the inherited territory. I mean, this could be rhetoric, and
yeah,
he could still mean it, I mean, in the moment he gives that answer. So why doesn't Weinfeld treat this as a proper historian should treat it, namely as a piece of rhetoric?
Yeah, I think he's just, obviously he's referring here to Simon's answer.
Yeah.
And you're right, he's taking it a little bit literally. Probably because also he's mentioning the Hasmoneans in passing.
Mm-hmm.
Still, his book is focused on biblical evidence. So, yeah, I mean, it doesn't really engage in a deep discussion. The evidence from 1 Maccabees.
It's
just taking it
pretty much. But it does have the aura of, I can't believe these other people keep saying this, so that the butt clause is like that. But, you know, look, as a matter of fact, it's been.
What interests me is that here is a scholar who is able to read the text
and see it plainly.
Like, okay, that's what the text says. The text doesn't say that they wanted to reconquer the promised land. The text says they wanted to hold on inherited territory. So after that, we can discuss why Simon says that and so on and so forth. But just to start with, let's look at the text at the literal level, and then we can dig deeper. So now I would like to get into 1 Maccabees, and I will start with the figure of Joshua. Since, as you've just read, it's been referred several times as being a model for the Israelites. Now, okay, so why 1 Maccabees? Maybe this is not clear to everybody. Here we have a scholarly consensus for once. 1 Maccabees is considered by really nearly all scholars as being written by a court historian very close to the Hasmonean dynasty, probably in the time of John Epaminondas, at the very end of the 2nd century BCE. So we don't have a better voice for the Hasmonean dynasty. We don't have, there is no other source except there are coins which could like speak for them in a closer way. Josephus is already much more critical, although he likes some of the Hasmoneans very much. And so that's why this is the best literary evidence that we can have for an Hasmonean perspective. Okay. Now, the point is that we have only one single reference to Joshua in the whole book, 1 Maccabees. And before we read this reference to Joshua in 1 Maccabees, I would like to read with you a similar passage in Ben-Sira, the wisdom of Ben-Sira, which is the praise of the fathers. You know, this was a kind of common literary pattern in ancient Jewish literature. You do the praise of the ancestors going through Abraham, Joseph, David, whatever. And of course, it's much more developed in the wisdom of Ben-Sira. It's much shorter in 1 Maccabees, which. So we shouldn't compare length, strictly speaking, but the tone, the what are the elements that they remember, that they wanted to put forward. Okay, so in the wisdom of Ben-Sira, we read, "Mighty in war was Jesus, son of Noah." So I'm taking the recent translation by Van Wright. "Mighty in war was Jesus, son of Noah, and a successor of Moses in the prophecies, who was like his name, great for the salvation his, that is God's elect, Israel, to take vengeance on enemies when stirred up, so that he might give Israel an inheritance. How he was glorified when he lifted up his hands and when he extended his sword against cities. Who before him stood so? For it was he who led the wars of the Lord. Was it not by his hand that the sun was shackled and one day became as two? Called upon the Most High, Mighty One, when enemies pressed him all around, and the great Lord hurled him with stones of hail of mighty power. He rushed down upon the nation in battle, and on a slope he destroyed those who resisted, so that nations might know his armies." Here the Hebrew, so far it's the Greek, it's a translation based on the Greek version. The Hebrew has, "so that every nation might know the chel." Because their battle was against the Lord, for indeed he followed after a mighty one. And in the days of Moses, he did mercy, and here the Hebrew as chesed, and I think it means actually he was faithful. He and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, to oppose an assembly, to restrain people from sin, and to still grumbling of wickedness. And these were the two that escaped out of the 600,000 infantry to lead them into an inheritance, into a land flowing with milk and honey. Okay, so that's Ben-Sira. Now, what do we read in 1 Maccabees? I put the whole passage on the praise of the fathers in 1 Maccabees. Remember, so this is a testament of Mattathias to his sons. "Remember the words of our fathers, which they did in their generations and received great glory and an everlasting name. Was not Abraham found faithful in temptation, and it was accounted to him as righteousness? Joseph, in the time of his affliction, observed the commandment and became lord of Egypt. Phinehas, our father, by becoming zealous with zeal, received a covenant of everlasting priesthood. Jesus, that is Joshua, by fulfilling the command, became a judge in Israel. Caleb, by bearing witness in the assembly, received an inheritance of land. David, by his mercy, inherited the throne of the kingdom forever. Elias, by becoming greatly zealous for the law, was taken up into heaven. Hananias, Azarias, and Mishael, because of their faith, were saved from fire. Daniel, by his simplicity, was rescued from the mouth of lions." Now, what strikes you?
No
conquest, no battles, no miracle. the wisdom of Ancira, the miracles, the extraordinary miracles performed by God for Joshua are cold, the sun that stopped, the stones that were thrown from heaven.
And all the most of these others, it's active. Abraham and Joseph and David and Elias, they did something, but Joshua just, I mean, it's not some overly active move that he's making. He just says, it's very...
Right, by fulfilling the command, this is quite active.
What command is Yahweh talking about? Yeah.
That's exactly the good question. En to pleros halogon. So, what was the logos that God gave to him? Now, if you look at Caleb just afterwards, by bearing witness in the assembly, and you will have noticed that in both texts, in Ben-Sira and in when Maccabees, Joshua and Caleb go together, I mentioned, one after the other. So the episode is Numbers 13-14, right? It's the mission given to the spies to go to the land, and you know, all the other spies, they say, oh, the people of the country, they are so big, so you know, so strong, we are never going to defeat them, and then the people are afraid and want to go. In the end, they will be punished for that, except for Joshua and Caleb, who are not punished, but on the contrary, rewarded, because they were faithful to the word that God had given, the command that God had given to say, go and take the land. So I think that there is a good chance that in 1 Maccabees 2:55, Jesus, Joshua, by fulfilling the command, became a judge in Israel, refers precisely to that episode. Just as Caleb, by bearing witness in the assembly, it's the same episode, it's the report that they did on their expedition.
Because the one follows the other, because they're...
Yeah, because apparently this is what has in mind.
He's,
I see your point. He's maybe not called a shofet, but he judges the people.
Oh.
So it's the verb, not the. But he's. If you look at his task, his role in the Bible, he certainly can be seen as the first judge, comparable to the other judges in the Book of Judges. And what is very interesting, and you're right to ask, why does this judge come out here? What is very interesting with the judges is that they are chosen from all kinds of tribes in Israel.
Mm-hmm.
It's not yet the system that if you're a descendant of David from the tribe of Judah, you are the legitimate political ruler in Israel. In the time of the judges, God picks up any person that he thinks he is the righteous one who is going to save Israel.
Mm-hmm.
And this is precisely the claim that 1 Maccabees is making for the Assyrians. Like, no matter what was their genealogy, their lineage, their family background, they are the ones that are chosen by God to rescue Israel. Yes?
So you invite us to think about passages that you're not quite quoting also. So I hope I don't know if you...
Go ahead.
But I hope I can just press you, because I do find your overall case convincing, but you stop it by stopping at 260, you're missing an allusion to Joshua in chapter 264 of First Maccabees. My children, be courageous and grow strong. Chazak ve'ematz.
So, why should it be just Joshua?
You're right, it's not just Joshua, though allusion-wise, right? I mean, Moses says that to Joshua, and Moses says that to the Israelites, but that is, I mean, that shows up in the book of Joshua, maybe 8 or 9 times or something like that. Those two verbs together. More than, I mean, so that would be, there's...
So you're saying that it's additionally evocative, that it's systematically...
Right, especially since Joshua's mentioned, you know, a few verses sooner. I don't think it's persuasive, I don't think it's overall...
He's mentioned with other people that are forward.
doesn't really seem to stand out particularly.
Joshua does. Oh no, I think that's right. I mean, that's not. It's a minor point. I don't think it's that, but it is. If someone were going to build a counter case,
yeah,
that's,
that could be
that's somewhere.
That
that's
that
would be.
But I don't think that it's only in the Book of Joshua.
No, it's not.
It's
no,
maybe
it's not.
Often
no, right.
In the Book of Joshua.
No, and it is the most
so,
evocative.
It's not. Extremely specific, I would say, just to say, be strong and, I mean, okay. That,
right, and it's actually followed into nomo, right, into the law, which isn't, so it's elusive, but it's not, right, I mean, there isn't conquest in 264 either, but anyway, it's just
it's
an illusion you may want to, you know, work into a footnote somewhere.
Yeah, no, very good point, thank you very much for that, that's very important.
But that can support the case that they're just a judge, right? Since they've already named Joshua as being a judge, the allusion to Joshua a few verses later, if that's what that is, could just support the case that Joshua is a judge, or that the Maccabees, like Joshua, should be judges.
Well, they are going to fight. I mean,
right. But I mean, that's what the judges do.
Fair enough, that's right.
We have to keep in mind that the author of the Maccabees is trying to use biblical vocabulary in all kinds of ways, and he's not always very consistent. Or you know, he's trying to make his books sound like the books of the Samuel and Kings. You know, look, if you look at the very end of the Maccabees, in chapter 16, when he says, "Oh, if you want to know the rest of the big deeds of John and Hannes, look at the books that were written." It's exactly the same formulation as the one found in the books of Kings in the Bible. So he wants to make his book on the Maccabean dynasty sound as one of these books concerning the great kings of Israel. And that's also a point that I can say right from the start, that he's really trying very hard to make the Maccabees look like the old kings of Israel, especially Saul, Jonathan, David. Many times there are explicit allusions to events that took place during their reigns, and Jonathan was not exactly a king, but he was son of Saul, but anyway.
So actually that is an argument that even further makes emphatic when it doesn't happen. So when the conquest is not alluded to in First Maccabees, then it's even more dramatic, because if so much language is particularly taken out and deployed to make this text sound more biblical, then when something is not there, it's more striking.
Yeah, absolutely. There could have been tons of ways to refer to Joshua, to the conquest, to the great, you know. He does it for other biblical passages.
Mm-hmm.
So why wouldn't have, you know, here the silence becomes significant.
Yes, that's
it's not just by chance.
Right.
Because if he wanted to make the point that they were like new Joshuas reconquering the land, he could have said so very explicitly. He nearly says that they are new Davids themselves, so why?
There's a good motivation for them not to, right? Joshua never succeeded in conquering Jerusalem.
Mm. Yeah.
Right, so isn't that, I mean, is that a very, I mean, that's, right, to a certain degree, the Maccabean success starts where Joshua's failure starts,
mm-hmm.
right? Right, in other words, they begin precisely in that place where Joshua never, right, so this is why they're going to go to David. This is why, I mean, this was the first thing that popped in my head. Why would anyone think of Joshua? It starts in Jerusalem. Right, right, that's not a thing.
Yeah, but I think they're really, they were looking for a kind of royal legitimacy.
Well, that's also right.
And we know that Alexander Janus really took the title of king, but even before, when you look at Simon, even when in one Maccabees, like in chapter 14, 15, when he's described as a king, and he doesn't take the title, he's already in the role. So, and even Jonathan, when he is allowed by the Seleucid king to take the purple mantle, so I think it was a.
Judges are a bad model if you care for your kid's future.
Yeah. So, are there other questions concerning this passage on Joshua, or shall we move to the next text?
Yeah.
I have a little, it's off the topic, so feel free to reject it. But what was this Abraham faithful and temptation reference?
Oh, yeah,
The temptation was.
The testing.
The test, testing.
Mm-hmm.
This is.
I was thrown off by the temptation.
It's clearly the reference to
but
the
this
test.
Is a midrashic combination of two different passages, because the temptation is in Genesis 32, but it was reckoned to him as righteousness is in Genesis 15.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So this is already kind of a creative combination of different.
Oh, that's nice.
Very nice point.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Would you push that
back?
Oh, sure. Thank you.
Okay. Then we can have a look at the second passage on the Chelem.
This is getting problematic. That's for you.
So, this is a little bit longer and more complex. Actually, we should, to do the job in the right way, we should be reading the whole chapter and compare it with passages from two Maccabees, but this would take at least 1 hour. So I try to shorten it a little bit and make it quicker. So I selected a few passages, and this is already long, from chapter 5. And what is it coming? As I said before, chapter 5, it's about the temple has been purified by Judah, and he hears about Jewish communities outside the borders of Judea that have been attacked by the surrounding nations. And he goes out on an expedition to rescue those Jews. So here is how the chapter starts. And it happened when the surrounding nations, the ethnic Kukluten, here again the wording, it's important. So I put a few things in Greek apparently so you can pay attention. Heard, but maybe I'm not going to read all of it.
The sound, allusion to the sound. Mm-hmm. The allusion to the sound.
Sound?
From a sound.
Sound?
P-S-A-L-M.
Oh, okay. Right. Well, there are other possible allusions to this. So when they heard that the altar had been built and the holy precinct had been rededicated as before, and they were greatly angered and decided to annihilate the race of Jacob who were in their midst. And they began to kill among the people to drive them out. And Judas made war against the sons of Esau in Idumea, against the Harbatim, because they were besieging Israel. And he struck them a mighty blow and reduced them and took their spoils. And he remembered the evil of the sons of Bayan, who were to the people as a snare and as a trap, by ambushing them on the road. And we go back later to this, to the Greek. And they were confined by him to the towers, and he marshaled his troops against them, and anathematized them. Kai anathematisen autus. This is the only occurrence of cherem in the whole book. Anathema or anathematizo. And burned their towers with fire together with all those who were inside. And he crossed over against the sons of Ammon, and found a strong band and many people with Timothy, their leader. And he engaged in many battles against them, and they were smashed before him, and he defeated them. And he occupied Yezer and his daughter, and returned to Judea. And the nations in Galaad gathered together against the Israelites who were within their borders to eliminate them, but they fled to the fortress of Datema. And they sent letters to Judah and his brothers, saying, "The nations around us are gathered together against us to annihilate us. And they are preparing to come and occupy the fortress in which we have taken refuge. And Timothy is the leader of their force. Now then, come and deliver us from their hand, for a multitude of us has fallen. And all our brothers who are in the area of Tubia have been killed, and they have captured their wives and their children and belongings and destroyed about 1,000 men there." Okay, so Judah goes and there are different digressions, but here it goes. And Judas, Maccabeus, and Jonathan, his brother, crossed over the Jordan and went 3 days' journey in the wilderness. And they came upon the Gambatians and met with them peacefully. And they related to them everything that had happened to their kindred in Galaadites, So we get an ad, and that many of them are captive in Bosra and Bosra in Alemna, Caspo, Maked, and Kamai. All these cities are fortified and raided. And in the remaining cities of Galad, it is also there are captives. There are marching troops to assault the fortresses tomorrow and to take them and to annihilate all these people in one day. And Judas and his army turned away by the road into the wilderness toward Bosra suddenly and took the city. And he killed every male by the edge of the sword and took all their spoils and burned it by fire. We go back to the Greek. And he departed from there by night, and they went as far as the fortress. And it happened in the morning, they lifted up their eyes, look, a large crowd of people, which was innumerable, carrying ladders and siege engines to take the fortress, and they were battling them. And Judas saw that the battle had begun, and the screaming of the city went up as far as heaven with trumpeting and great screaming, and he said to the men of his force, fight to them for our kindred, we came from the day from Hemor, our brothers. And he went out in three divisions and from behind them, and they trumpeted with the trumpets and cried out in prayer. And the army of Timothy recognized that it was Maccabees, and they fled from before him, but he struck them a heavy blow, and up to 8,000 of their men fell on that day. And he turned aside to Mapha and made war on it and took it. And he killed every male in it and took its spoils and burned it with fire. From there he departed and occupied Caspo, Maked, and Bosor, and the remaining cities of Galadis. And the nations were smashed from before him. I mean, And the nations were smashed from before him, and they threw down their weapons and fled to the sacred precinct in Kamai. And they occupied the city and burned the sacred precinct with fire together with all who were in it. And Kamai was vanquished, and they were no longer able to stand before the gates. So this is the text that scholars rely on to say that the Hasmoneans used the cherem against the surrounding populations. Okay, so first I would like to read with you Deuteronomy 20, 10, 18, which is the very important passage from Deuteronomy on the laws concerning wars in ancient Israel, where we find the law of cherem against the Canaanites. So Deuteronomy 20 says, when you come, so it's God talking to Israel, when you come nigh into a city to fight against it, then proclaim peace unto it, and it shall be, if it make you your answer of peace and open unto you, then it shall be that all the people that is found therein shall be tributaries unto you, and they shall serve you. And if it will make no peace with you, but will make war against you, then you shall besiege it. And when the Lord your God has delivered it into your hands, you shall smite every male thereof with the edge of the sword. But the women and the little ones and the cattle and all that is in the city, even all the spoil thereof, you shall take unto yourself, and you shall eat the spoil of your enemies, which the Lord your God has given you. Thus shall you do unto all the cities which are very far off from you, which are not of the cities of these nations, Canaanite nations, but of the cities of these people, which the Lord your God does give you for an inheritance, you shall save alive nothing that please, but you shall utterly destroy them, namely the Hittites and the Amorites, the Canaanites and the Perizzites, the Hivites and the Jebusites, as the Lord your God has commanded you, that they teach you not to do after all their abominations which they have done unto their gods. So should you sin against the Lord your God. Okay, so here we have two clearly different cases. The cities in Canaan, in the land that God gives to Israel, the lands of the Canaanites, and the cities that are outside, far off, outside the land. So now, let me ask you, we have read the description of the fights of Judah against the surrounding nations in 1 Maccabees. To which case does it correspond, in your opinion?
But if they're the surrounding nations, then you should treat them the way they're told in Deuteronomy, how you treat the people in the surrounding nations, right? But they're treating them with a cherem, imposing on them harsh measures, that are comparable to how we're supposed to treat the Kedem people. Would that be a good idea?
Are they really treating them as a Kedem?
No, actually, they're really? Using the same, if you check the Greek, actually, they're using the same languages, the language and expression that they used for the first group.
So, give me an example. Mm-hmm.
But since they were considered to have taken, to be threatening Jews, there was no peace that could be offered to them because there was already a kind of declaration of war. Alright? But look at the way, look at what it says. Repeatedly, where I have put the Greek, like in the case of Bosora and Tumafa, and even one could argue in the case of Karnai, although it may be a different case. So you have this, he killed every male by the edge of the sword and took all their spoils. And again, in verse 35, and he killed every male and took its spoils, and then he burned the city with fire. Now, when you kill the males and you take the spoil, what is the case? What is the situation that we are talking about? Is it a cherem? So I repeat Deuteronomy 20, verse 13. When the Lord your God has delivered it into your hands, you shall smite every male thereof with the edge of the sword. But the women and the little ones and the cattle and all that is in the city, even all the spoil thereof, you shall take unto yourself. And you shall eat the spoil of your enemies, which the Lord your God has given. Thus shall you do unto all the cities that are very far off from you.
So it's a just war, justified.
Absolutely, because the Jews were attacked first. Judah is going to rescue them. Okay, but you will tell me we still have a problem at the beginning of the chapter. Because at the beginning of the chapter, I have two things. Now, first, the issue of the nations round about. That makes a good thing. Because he said it's also an expression that is found repeatedly in the book of Nehemiah. When Nehemiah has reconstructed the walls of Jerusalem, or starts to reconstruct the walls of Jerusalem, the text says that the nations round about became angry and started to fall upon the Jews that were living in their midst. Exactly the same situation. So here we have a description of, an implicit description of Judah as a new Nehemiah, the new governor from Jerusalem. He's like, he's the new ruler in Jerusalem, and he's doing the same thing as Nehemiah did, with the same consequences. But we have more than that. Now, let's go to the sons of Bayan. So we have a fight in Idumea to start with. Okay, Idumea at the time was the southern part of Judea. As a matter of fact, it was in the promised land, I would say. It wasn't on the western shore. It was now on the eastern shore. Although it may have been a bit also on the eastern shore. Here we are probably speaking about Idumea, you know, southern Judea. And the author says he made war against the sons of Esau, meaning the Edomites, it means, okay? And he distinguishes a particular group, which is the sons of Bayan. It sounds like a tribe of some kind, or maybe nomads, or it's very difficult to know exactly who they represent. And pay attention to the way they are described. They wear to the people as a snare and as a trap by ambushing them on the roads. Now they were a spandidak and scandalon, and to enedroin autos and as odois. Here we have two allusions. One is in fact to Joshua, to a passage in Joshua speaking about the Canaanites. Like they could be a snare and a trap because of their idolatry. But here we are speaking about a snare and a trap that are concrete and that are real threats. A threat on the lives of Jews. They were attacking people. They were attacking people entas odois, on the ways. And this is very, very reminiscent of the description of Amalek attacking Israel on the ways. And here we should have looked, I didn't put all the passages, so many. But it's Deuteronomy 25 or Deuteronomy 28. I can have a look. So, in which Amalek is described as, you know, precisely using this expression, and we have also, of course, the story in Exodus that you are going after Israel on the way and attacking, in a kind of very unfair way, those who were weak at the end of the column. So I think that the anathema, which here in the Hebrew must be cherem, there is no doubt about it, because this is a systematic translation in the Septuagint. Mm-hmm. Anathema, it always has a Hebrew counterpart, cherem, or anathema hizo le'achrim. So here, there is no doubt, when the writer, the Hebrew author, the author of the Hebrew version of the Maccabees wrote this, he used le'achrim. So we have the cherem here, and we have this curious group, the sons of Bayan, who are reminiscent of the Amalekites. Now, as you know, the Amalekites are the other group in the Bible that has to be put to the ban, to the cherem. And they are put to the ban in 1 Samuel 15. So they were the ones who attacked Israel on the ways, and they are the ones who are also put to the ban by Saul in 1 Samuel 15. Only that Saul made a little mistake, because he spared the life of the Amalekite king, Agag, and he was punished by God for not having respected the Haran. And from that moment on, he stopped being the legitimate king of Israel. Okay? Now, I would like you to have a look at a passage in 1 Samuel 14, which describes Saul's expeditions. And I would like to remember, before we look at 1 Samuel 14, I would like to remind you of 1 Samuel 11, a passage that Betsy Swall scholars know very well, because we have the beginning of this chapter in the Masoretic Qumran that we do not have in the Masoretic text. What is this about? It's the story. Saul has just been chosen as king of Israel. And the end of chapter 10 says that there were some bad guys who doubted his legitimacy as Israel's ruler, as Israel's king, in spite of Samuel's anointing of Saul, etc. And what happens? We have this terrible war going on in Ammon, in the territories of Bnei Ammon, and we have this terrible wicked king, Nahash, the serpent, who is attacking Jews in where? In Yabesh, in Gilead. Look at it. Think about it here. It's repeatedly emphasized that the Jews were threatened precisely in Galaad. And Judah went to Galaad to rescue the Jews. Galaaditis in Greek. Galaad. It's all the same. Now, so we have Saul going on a military expedition to rescue the Jews from Gilead, from the hands of the king Nahash, the Ammonite. And he brings the Jews back, he rescues them, he defeats Nahash, and after that, he is considered an absolutely legitimate king of Israel, to the point that the people won't kill the Bnei Belial who criticized him. You see the legitimacy gained through the rescuing operation? Now, my argument is that the story of Judah rescuing the Jews in Galaadites and other places, which is not found in 2 Maccabees, strangely enough, which is really particular to 1 Maccabees, this story is modeled after the story of Saul's expeditions. And now I would like us to read 1 Samuel 14, 47, 48. which is a kind of summary of Saul's military expeditions. What does the text say? So Saul took the kingdom over Israel and fought against all his enemies on every side, against Moab, and against the children of Ammon, and against Edom, and against the kings of Zobah, and against the Philistines. And whithersoever he turned himself, he vexed them. And he gathered the host and smote the Amalekites and delivered Israel out of the hands of them that spoiled them. Now, if we identify the sons of Beeren with Amalekites, which would explain why they are attacking Israel on the ways and why they are subjected to the ban, to the Cheren, we have the Amalekites for Judah, we have Moab and Ammon and Edom, and we have the Philistines, because the end of chapter 5 says that Judah then went to the coast and he attacked Ashdod and he just got rid of a few Allogenes over there, which is a translation in the Septuagint for Philistines. So, I think it makes sense to look at the description in chapter 5 of Judah's battles as a reenactment of Saul's saga.
So can I ask a very ignorant question from the point of view of a non-text person? Does this mean that you don't think it happened?
It's post-Rabbinical. I think it did. It certainly, I doubt it happened the way it is described here. But we have the parallel stories in 2 Maccabees. And this, okay, we don't have time to look at them in detail right now, but what is the main difference? There are several differences between 1 Maccabees and 2 Maccabees. First, in 2 Maccabees, it's not like a one big expedition. It's part of it is in chapter 10, and part of it is in chapter 12. But it was much better in order to make, to get the impression it was like Saul's expeditions, we just presented in one chapter. Mm-hmm. So this is the way I enter this difference, for instance. But the main difference is that in 2 Maccabees, the battles are mainly against Seleucid forces.
Uh-huh.
Also in 1 Maccabees, you saw that in Timothy, at least twice in the text. So it's not that he denies that there were some Seleucid forces, but he really emphasizes that this is about the nations attacking the Jews. Whereas in 2 Maccabees, you have the story of the people in Yamnia who attacked the Jews, which is not at all mentioned in 1 Maccabees 5. So it's a different place, it's not the same people, But apart from that, it's just battles between Judah's forces and the Seleucid armies. It's not at all about burning cities or, a fight with the Gentiles, with the nations round about. It's a very different story.
So it's a little bit like what the kind of disclaimer that you see in a movie that says it's based on true events.
Kind of. Yeah. There is a basis, but then the version is quite different from the version in 2 Maccabees.
So just to say, as a...
And sorry, but this makes much more sense, because in the rest of the first chapters of 1 Maccabees, it only speaks about battles with Seleucid forces.
Uh-huh.
2 Maccabees is also a very interesting detail that is not present in 1 Maccabees. It says also that in Idumea there were not only Seleucid forces, but opponents of Judah. The bad Judeans who collaborated with Seleucid forces. And we do not hear anything about them in 1 Maccabees, but in 2 Maccabees, we see that there are also some Judean groups who opposed the Asmoneans in these fights. So we have a different story, really.
This particular chapter and its analog in 2 Maccabees, just to say, archaeologists who excavate in this region with complete aplomb and no apology, they will find, a floor with some broken pottery on it and some evidence of fire, and they will say, as they have said at Yamnia, for example, Judah Maccabee was here.
David's palace this summer with my family.
That's an entirely different story, but yes,
it's very impressive.
Yeah, but it's precisely. I mean,
it's the power of narrative.
It's the power of narrative.
Stones don't have a narrative, but here we are in Ireland.
And what is your idea then about modeling this passage on Sound Saga? So, if you believe that the Maccabees had not a narrative of conquest, yeah, for themselves, was it then the author of the letters who started to look for models in order to bring in some grander, sort of Ur texts that could give the events sort of inherent,
sense.
Exactly. So why then model it according to Saul?
I think because the author of the Maccabees is trying to present them as the new kings of Israel. Like they are as worthy of the, and Judah is even more worthy than Saul, if you think about it, because he doesn't fail in, he puts the sons of Priam to the ban completely.
So would you think the rulers themselves, or Simon and then and so on, they didn't think of themselves as kings and not yet, they didn't have the aim of becoming kings?
Oh, no, I'm sure they
so
they wanted power and they wanted to rule and they just wanted to, the problem for them was that they were priests. And although we have some precedents for a priest being in the position of a ruler, a political ruler, the problem with the Maccabees is that they were also military generals, which for a priest becomes a little bit more problematic. It's not just about being a political leader, it's about being a military general with all kinds of issues of impurity, of corpse impurity in battle and things like that. And if you look at the evidence from Quran, they deeply resented the fact the Assyrians were both political, military, and priestly rulers. They didn't like that at all because the fact of accumulating all the roles, And so they tried to legitimate this bold move, like just to take all the power into their hands and to hold it very firmly and to pass it on to their descendants. So at least this is what the author of the Maccabees is doing very clearly. And we may suppose that it reflects something of what the Assyrians themselves wanted to.
But you would distinguish him as a voice.
Yeah.
From the Assyrians themselves. That is what I'm trying to figure out.
We have, the text doesn't say that it was written by one of the Assyrians. So maybe it was a command. Maybe John and Cannon said, I would like you to write the great deeds of my ancestors, my father and my uncles. Maybe it was very with clear indications, but still, apparently there was an author.
It's written with hindsight.
It has a clear perspective, direction, but I can't say, I don't know how much Johnny Akanis or someone else was involved in controlling what was written. We can't know. But it seems to be written by someone who was close to them.
Can I add two more questions?
Yes.
So even though it doesn't seem to be a systematic idea of reconquest, there is some systematics in it in the way all the other peoples are presented to attack. Yeah, and it's very episodic. So when I read it in preparation, I felt, they are just ambushing here and they are doing something here. We always respond. Yeah, we react. But when you read it, it's very fast paced. It sounds as if there is a very unstable, unruly region where everybody, every tribe is just making some mess. And they have to respond. And that's, at least for the reader, in the end, creates some systematics.
Mm-hmm.
That is one thing that is just an outside reader's impression. And the other is, in the text that we read first, the inheritance of our father, so Simon's speech, I was really, really interested in the use of the term kairos.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that he says, they took their chance and conquered these lands, and now I took my chance.
Mm-hmm.
And as kairos being a good word to actually describe this episodical structure of the entire letter, and still, it seems that there is more than kairos in the whole how actually they're gaining power, the Hasmoneans gaining power is described. Yeah? I mean, they don't say it's destiny, nor do they say it's war, right, in this passage, yeah? But kairos. But in the end, we are presented with more than just kairos.
Okay, yeah. Very interesting point. And I think we will go back
sorry,
to Simon's answer later, but as far as your remarks on the people surrounding them are concerned, the peoples, it's true that there is a kind of antagonistic vision of the people around. But on the other hand, even when you read the book carefully, you see it's more nuanced than that, in spite of all. For instance, in the very passage we read, there is this reference to the Nabateans, with whom they met peacefully.
Yes.
Which means that you still can have some kind of good relationships with certain people. So it's not everybody is necessarily at war with the Judeans.
Yeah.
And then we will have also the friendship and even we will have the friendship and alliance with the Romans, and we will have the friendship and the kinship with the Spartans. And
yes.
So it's not black and white like all the Gentiles are, only evil.
Yeah,
even if it tends to be, I mean, yeah, first reading of the book gives this impression very strongly. And it's, especially in comparison with two Maccabees, which is even more nuanced and can really recognize that there are some good Gentiles. But even one Maccabees still is nuanced in some ways.
Yeah,
not
yeah.
Everybody is evil.
I think you mentioned in passing that this was originally written in Hebrew.
Yeah.
And how do we know that?
Oh, there are many, many Hebrew formulations. You can easily go back to the Hebrew from several passages in the Greek. It's not good Greek at all. It's full of syllogisms. And there is a complete consensus on this issue. Nobody argues in those.
Even though there's no fragments of the Hebrew.
No, unfortunately, we don't have. We have no fragments of our Maccabees from Qumran. Not surprising. We think that they're
right.
Pretty much against the Hasmonean dynasty.
But I mean, her point about Kairos, I wonder like, what would have been the Hebrew underlying that?
Maybe. Mm-hmm. Maybe.
Do you think it's possible and likely that the book of First Maccabees is answering and asking different questions than historians are asking right now? In the sense of, if it was written for Hasmonean propaganda, what piece of propaganda is historically accurate? I mean, if you look at Sennacherib's prison and you look at 2 Kings 20, those are two different stories. Right? So, I mean, why should we expect First Maccabees to be any different?
Well, I don't expect it to be different.
I mean, but it seems that scholars, though, have expected it to be different. I mean, throughout the history of scholarship, and it to actually be a record of what actually occurred.
Well, we do know that the Hasmonean state came to exist.
Oh, sure. Well, I mean,
and it didn't just show up. Without people fighting.
Well, we didn't know.
So while I think our presenters may point out, we obviously can't follow the overall sequence of battles precisely here because we had a counter argument.
Right.
The overall sense that they beat somebody and won, I think we can grant that, right?
Sure.
We have Greco-Roman evidence.
Sure.
What that means.
Yeah. Well,
so.
I'm not saying the book is absolutely inaccurate. What I'm trying to say is, if you look at what Sennacherib wrote in Sennacherib's prison, and you look at what the Deuteronomistic historian wrote in 2 Kings 20, those are two different stories. Something obviously happened. Something occurred. But the purpose of both of the authors is different. And so I'm not trying to say that we throw it out, but we need to read it more selectively than it has been read.
Well,
and read between the lines for what it actually happened, not what the propagandists for the Hasmonean dynasty said, right?
Yeah, but as we discussed at the seminar yesterday evening, I think this has to do with some wider cultural, political context in the 20th century.
Right.
It's really the historiographical problem of skulls being also influenced by their own context and time. And yeah, I mean, the Maccabean story is the story of the last Jewish autonomous state before 1948. So this is a very, very important thing to take into account. It makes the story of the Maccabees very powerful in a modern context. So. Yeah, that is another nice case of misreading, ideological misreading of the evidence. So, yeah, that's where it comes into play. Mm-hmm. Shall we look quickly at the third text? I'm sorry for the discussion of the main text, which is Simon's answer, but. I have written everything I had to say in an article that was published in JBL last year, so anybody who's interested, I can send you a PDF. So. And I don't have to repeat myself. So, the third passage is the only occurrence of the term Canaan in the book. It's when Maccabees 9, Judah is dead, and you have Jonathan and Simon, who have another brother called John, Johannes, and he is killed by some guys called the Sons of Yambri. We do not identify them very clearly either. Probably another tribe, like in the Idumean, Nabatean area. And this is the, so we better read the text directly. You will see what it's all about. So the sons of Yambri from Medaba came out and seized Johannes and everything that he had, and having them, went away. After these developments, they announced to Jonathan and to Simon, his brother, that the sons of Yambri are holding a big wedding and are bringing the bride from Medaba, the daughter of one of the great nobles of Canaan, with a large convoy. And they remembered the blood of Johannes, their brother, and they went up and hid under the cover of the mountain. And they lifted up their eyes and saw, and look, a commotion and a large entourage. And the bridegroom and his friends and his brothers came out to meet them with drums and musicians and many weapons. And they rose up against them from the ambush and killed them. And many wounded fell, and the rest fled to the mountain, and they took all their spoils. And the wedding changed to mourning, and the sound of the musicians to lamentation. And they exacted vengeance for the blood of their brother and returned to the marshment of the Jordan. Now, again, this passage has been used to show that the Assyrians looked at the people around them as Canaanites. And that they were practicing the cherem against the groups that they encountered. But if we look at this text carefully, first, who is the man who is one of the great nobles of Canaan? It is the father of the bride. We're not even sure that he's there when the attack happens. And he's not the one who's being targeted. The ones who are being targeted are the sons of Yambri, those who have killed Johannes, Jonathan, and Simon's brother.
And it's revenge.
Moreover, the text explicitly says that it was in Iglesias, it was a vengeance, because their brother had been killed.
Mm-hmm.
There is no issue of a religious war against idolatry or, you know, Canaanites or whatsoever. It's just a vengeance against a group of nomads or whatever. And they happen to have this girl with them, just got married, whose father is described as one of the great nobles of Canaan. Now, why do we have this term Canaan here? Sorry, I'm repeating myself.
No, it's fine.
Because I already explained that to our class this morning. So, we have several ways of understanding this. First, we could say it's just a slip of the pen, and it's, you know, because he's using using so much biblical language, at some point he's just having this kind of biblical expression coming into his mind. But it's not really meaningful. Okay, maybe. Second thing, maybe more convincing, is to argue that here, since we have to suppose that we have to think about the Hebrew original version of the text. So we suddenly have Canaan in the Hebrew original. But what do we see in biblical texts in the late period? We see that the noun Canaanite, starts to mean merchant. Why? Probably because of the association with Phoenicians. You know, you have Canaanites also in Phoenicia. We have some evidence, even from coins, that some Phoenician cities saw themselves as being part of Canaan. It's very striking from the Hellenistic period. So, and the Phoenicians were great travelers and merchants. So it's not, I mean, we can understand why in Hebrew the term Na'ani came to mean merchant. And here is an example from Isaiah 23:8. Here in the Hebrew, you have a parallel between two words, Sochareha and Kinaneha. In the English, you have the translation, who has taken this counsel against Tyre, the crowning city, whose merchants are princes, whose traffickers are the parables of the earth. So, Sochareim here is translated by merchants, and Knaanim is translated by traffickers. And the Greek is not a very exact, very precise translation of the Hebrew in this case. Yeah, this is the word Salim. So they translate Salim by Arkantes, but actually they are not really translating Knaanim, which is the parallel in the Hebrew makes clear that the term Knaanim here is a synonym of Socholim, that is merchants. So it is within the Hebrew, it's not in the translation, it's within the Hebrew, it's clear this is the meaning of the term Knaanim in this context. And note that it is a Tyrian, Phoenician context.
Wait, they're turning things around because Nech, Nech, Ade, Aretz is Arhantes, Tes, Gaze, whereas.
They are putting together Salim and Nech, Ade, Aretz. And it becomes Arhantes, Tes, Gaze. Princes, it becomes like Sarai. And the endoxoi corresponds to nich b'di. I mean, it's a reformulation of the Greek. They are putting things in a different order. So, but they are translating really the term. Mm-hmm. That's my
point. Right.
Now, if we look at Proverbs 31:24, it's the, you know, the praise of the worthy woman. So the Hebrew says, Sadin asta vatimkor v'chagor matna leknan. She made fine linen and sold it and delivered girdles unto the merchant. And here again, it's some. I mean, she's selling girdles, not to Canaanites, but to merchants.
But the Greek makes it.
But the Greek keeps the. I mean, it's not even. It's not exactly a translation. It's a transliteration. And there is another interesting example, which is, but there it's in complete confusion. It's Zechariah 11:7. In which we have in the Greek,
Greek,
Kai Kolmano Tabobatat Esfages Eisten Kanaanitin, whereas, so I will feed the flock of slaughter into Canaanitis, which would be a Greek way to say the land of Canaan, or to Canaan. Whereas in the Hebrew, we don't have that at all. We have va'ere et son a'arega, until then, all fine. I will feed the flock of slaughter. Lachem anire et son, which would be le Canaane. You know, if you don't separate the two words, you can read Ktani or something like that.
With your end nonce?
So, to make a long story short, we could perfectly imagine that we had in the Hebrew original from Maccabees the term Ktani, which then became in the Greek Knaan, like literally, like. We have the word in Hebrew meaning merchant in the original from Maccabees, which would make sense because it's like the area between Nabatea, Judea, Gaza, you know, there were the spices roads, there was a lot of exchange, commercial exchange in these areas. You could have a big merchant that has been translated literally as one of the great nobles of Mecca. So that's my proposition. Understand this just one time occurrence of the term, which really doesn't make sense in any way.
And it's not a big deal anyway.
And it's not a big deal anyway because it's not even the guy who's being killed. But anyway, not just, you know, if you want to try to explain the text, you have to explain everything in the text. So. Oh, 5 minutes left. maybe just one short comment on Simon's answer. So I'm sorry, we should really spend another 2 hours on the passage on the exchange between Antiochus the Seventh and Simon. It's a very interesting, very complex text, which also should be read in the wider context of chapter 15 as a whole and of the book as a whole. Because there are many echoes in Simon's answer, in the formulation of Simon's answer. There are many echoes of Seleucid discourse as it is put in the mouth of Seleucid rulers by the author of 1 Maccabees. So
wow.
It is a literal reconstruction. It is intentional. And I will just tell you in a nutshell that the expression Ekleonomiatum Pasivum Hemum for me resonates very strongly with the affirmation at the beginning of the chapter of Antiochus saying that he is reconquering the retaking the kingdom of his fathers, a Basileia to the